is in hybrid format, obviously. In 2019, a doctor's office in the Mahoning Valley in Ohio, the Youngstown area, experienced this disturbing attack. Hackers locked the office computers, making them unusable. They even faxed over a ransom note promising to unlock the computers if the practice turned over $75,000 in Bitcoin. Not long ago, a Syrian group tied to Al-Qaeda put out a call for donations to help buy weapons. Their social media posts said that supporters should, quote, donate anonymously with cryptocurrency. A week ago, the Justice Department announced an indictment of two individuals who allegedly turned the profits of scams into cryptocurrency. Then they'd send the crypto overseas where it'd be turned back into cash. This committee's been examining digital assets to learn how they work and the risks they create for consumers and the financial system. We've also considered how digital assets can put workers' hard-earned money at risk. We're here today because crypto also can be used to make it easier to commit crimes, facilitating illicit finance, terrorism, other forms of criminal activity, and threatening our national security. Bad actors around the world, hackers, scammers, drug traffickers, to terrorist groups, pariah regimes have sought digital assets to facilitate their crimes and intimidation. October 2020, under the last administration, the Justice Department concluded, quote, cryptocurrency technology plays a role in many of the most significant criminal national security threats that the United States faces. To be sure, criminals have tried to cover their tracks for years with sham accounting and banks that looked the other way. But there's a simple reason that crypto appeals to crime rings and scam artists. The dollar has safeguards to protect against crime and illicit activity. Companies that deal with real money are required to know their customers and report suspicious transactions. They need to keep records. And even when crypto companies are covered by the law, too many don't play by the same rules, especially offshore crypto operators that are not subject to U.S. law. Shady crypto companies that fail to adequately monitor activity in their platforms essentially give criminals a green light. Digital assets make it easier to move money under pseudonyms. They make it easier for money launderers to use webs of transactions across the globe to cover their tracks, and that makes it harder for law enforcement to trace illicit funds. FinCEN, the Financial Crimes Enforcement Network, the Treasury Bureau charged with safeguarding our financial system from abuse, warned last week that Russian actors could even use crypto to get around sanctions. So sophisticated bad actors can use digital assets in the way that if they were using dollars would likely raise red flags and get them stopped in their tracks. Last year, FinCEN fined a crypto exchange $100 million. For 6 years, the only identification the company bothered to get from customers was an email address. The no questions asked approach enabled more than $200 million in suspicious transactions. But the problem isn't only shoddy compliance, it's more fundamental. We hear all the time about how innovative cryptocurrency is, but criminals innovate too. Crypto allows money launderers and terrorists to do things they never could have done with dollars. There's a whole new vocabulary to explain cryptocurrency illicit activity. Take what's known as chain hopping. That's when someone launders money by changing funds from one cryptocurrency ecosystem to another to make it harder to track. Or look at so-called rug pulls. That's when you set up a sham digital asset project online, raise as much money as you can, scamming investors all the while, and then run off with the cash. Then there's Hydra, the world's largest darknet. It's an online black market for drugs, for stolen credit card numbers, for cyber attack services, all enabled by crypto. Our laws and law enforcement agencies need to keep pace with these bad actors that will exploit every opportunity and stay with the old cliche, one step ahead of the law. And so far, with lax rules and little oversight, we've given them plenty of those opportunities. Crypto lets money launderers and hackers and rogue regimes invent new ways to hide and move money in the dark. It lets hackers and scammers create new ways to steal or defraud, and if we allow them to get out ahead of us, our safety and security are at risk. Law enforcement is doing what it can. They use techniques to stop cybercrime that didn't exist 3 decades ago. Financial regulators leverage new data and resources to expose fraud and manipulation in our markets. Crypto technology also embeds information that allows law enforcement and national security officials to track and trace where it's been, though not necessarily who owns it. That's where the tough new money laundering beneficial ownership law that we all passed bipartisanly last year will help. But as these problems continue to grow, we can't sit on the sidelines. We need to take a clear-eyed look at how these assets can endanger consumers and our security. Last month, the FBI announced the creation of a new unit dedicated to tracking down illicit crypto. The Justice Department's dedicating more resources and staff to cracking down on crime using digital assets. We need to take a whole-of-government approach to the problem if we're going to keep up with crypto and illicit finance. President Biden understands that. His executive order on crypto assets last week will drive progress on this issue. It was comprehensive. It was done right. It will jumpstart a coordinated strategy from law enforcement and regulators to fight bad actors who want to use crypto. Ultimately, we just can't sit back and watch cyber criminals and rogue regimes and terrorists and others create a shadow financial system that works essentially only for them. The financial system should work for American families and small businesses. Everything we do in this committee has that goal in mind. It means we can't let abuses of digital assets endanger our financial and our national security. As crypto evolves, this committee must continue to work together to craft a way forward on these issues. The stakes are high. The American people count on us. Ranking Member Toomey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This hearing is about digital assets and illicit finance. And while this is an important topic and it's inappropriate to discuss and understand this topic, we also need to work to ensure regulatory clarity for digital assets. Digital assets, including cryptocurrencies and their underlying distributed ledger technology, have enormous potential benefits. Some are already being realized. As the White House itself recently stated, the U.S. must maintain its leadership in this space, which is why lawmakers and regulators should do nothing to harm America's longstanding tradition of fostering technological innovation. Unfortunately, I am concerned that the current lack of regulatory clarity here at home is undermining that trend, that tradition, and driving innovation abroad. We need Congress to work together to enact a regulatory framework specific to digital assets that provides this much-needed clarity. And while today's topic is illicit finance, I think an important backdrop for the hearing is Russia's invasion of Ukraine. By starting the largest land war in Europe since World War II, Russia has unleashed the greatest threat to global security in recent memory. The sanctions imposed thus far by the Biden administration are harmful to the Russian economy, but not crippling. Sanctions have purposefully allowed Russia to continue exporting oil and gas, funding Putin's war machine with what could be as much as $5 to $7 billion each week coming from the West. Cutting off this revenue stream and getting more lethal aid to Ukraine are the two things we could do to maximize the chances that Ukraine wins this war and Putin comes to understand this war was a calamitous mistake. To cut off Putin's oil and gas sales globally, the administration and Congress should impose secondary sanctions on Russia's entire financial sector. This would force the world to choose between doing business with Russia or with the United States. I urge the administration to impose these sanctions and give Ukraine a fighting chance to win this war. Now, I am concerned that part of today's hearing will be spent disparaging cryptocurrencies and trying to draw some connection between them and Russian sanction evasions. Now, there's no sanctions regime that's completely watertight, so it's possible that there's an oligarch somewhere that may be using a variety of tools, including crypto, to try to hide some assets. But according to administration officials across multiple agencies, there's simply no evidence of cryptocurrencies being used by Russia to evade sanctions in any significant way. Just this month, FBI Director Christopher Wray told the Senate Intelligence Committee that the Russian, quote, "The Russians' ability to circumvent the sanctions with cryptocurrency is probably highly overestimated," end quote. Acting FinCEN Director Him Das said, and I quote, "We have not seen widespread evasion of our sanctions using methods such as cryptocurrency," end quote. And the Director of Cybersecurity for the National Security Council said, and I quote, "The scale that Russia would need to successfully circumvent all U.S. and partners' financial sanctions would almost certainly render cryptocurrency as an ineffective primary tool for the state," end quote. So the facts are clear, and the administration has discovered this. Russia cannot meaningfully use cryptocurrencies to evade current sanctions. And while there's been virtually no evidence of that evasion taking place, Ukraine has been actively using cryptocurrencies to do tremendous good. Cryptocurrency donations for Ukraine have reached about $100 million, which has helped Ukrainians defend their country against this terrible invasion. These funds have gone towards more than 5,500 bulletproof vests. They've bought 500 helmets and over 410,000 meals, among other things. Ukraine's Deputy Minister of Digital Transformation has said that, and I quote, each and every helmet and vest bought via crypto donations is currently saving Ukrainian soldiers' lives, end quote. We're fortunate to have as a witness today someone deeply affected by the war in Ukraine and the use of cryptocurrency to help Ukraine and its citizens. Michael Chubanian is the founder of Kuna Exchange, a local cryptocurrency exchange based in Ukraine. For the past several weeks, Mr. Chubanian has been instrumental in coordinating efforts so individuals all around the world can contribute cryptocurrencies in support of Ukraine's defense. Crypto's remarkable nature is that anyone across the globe can contribute to this type of effort almost instantaneously and at very low cost. It is in this context that we should examine cryptocurrencies and their relation to illicit finance. Throughout history, criminals have always tried to utilize new technologies for nefarious gain. But that's not a reason to stifle new technology developments. Crypto can be used to empower individuals and promote personal autonomy, but it can also support the detection and prevention of illicit crime. According to Chainalysis, transactions involving illicit addresses account for 0.15%. That's less than 0.2% of cryptocurrency transaction volumes last year. And this should be no great surprise. The traceable nature of most cryptocurrencies, is a factor making them terribly risky to use for criminal purposes. Just look at the Colonial Pipeline hack, which was one of the most disruptive ransomware attacks on record. The Department of Justice recovered 85% of the bitcoins that the pipeline paid in ransom, dealing a very significant blow to the hackers. One of today's witnesses, Michael Mosier, can speak directly about the characteristics of cryptocurrencies that help detect criminal activity. Mr. Mosier is the former acting director of the Financial Crimes Enforcement Network at FinCEN at the U.S. Treasury Department. His government experience makes him uniquely qualified to discuss the topics before us today. Today, I hope the committee takes a thoughtful and reasonable approach to this topic, acknowledging both the risks that cryptocurrencies present, but also their incredible potential. I thank the witnesses for their testimony and participation today, and I look forward to the discussion.
Thank you, Senator Toomey. I'll introduce the four witnesses. We'll hear from Jonathan Levin, co-founder, chief strategy officer at Chainalysis, Inc. Michael Mosier, the general counsel of Espresso Systems and former acting director and deputy director, digital innovation officer at FinCEN. They both are sitting at the table in front of us. And appearing remotely, as Senator Toomey said, Michael Chubanian, founder of Kuna Exchange, president of Blockchain Association of Ukraine. Welcome. And Shane Stansberry, a fellow at the Duke University School of Law, former assistant U.S. attorney. Mr. Levin, please proceed. Thank you.
Chairman Brown, Ranking Member Toomey, and distinguished members of the committee, thank you for having me here today to testify about this topic at an important time as we put significant sanctions on Russia to end the war in the Ukraine, and we work together on a full government digital asset policy as according to President Biden's executive order put in place last week. My name is Jonathan Levin, and I co-founded Chainalysis 8 years ago with Michael Groninger. At the turn of the 20th century, my family fled the pogroms in Eastern Europe to look for a better life in the West. They left with nothing. People in the Ukraine today are fleeing their homes and crossing borders, leaving loved ones and possessions behind. We as a global community have come together at an unprecedented pace to counter this movement. This has been due to the speed of information that is possible with the internet. And this ultimately has to be matched with the speed and inclusiveness of finance. The transparency that the internet has created about these atrocities has not been matched by the transparency realized in financial services. Bitcoin and Ethereum are technologies that pose the greatest opportunity to increase the degree of transparency in financial services, include the excluded, and create new ways for commerce to happen. Bitcoin has evolved over the last decade. It started off as just a promising technology, but today there is a community of more than 100 million people who depend on it. It has also spurred the creation of other digital communities. commerce, such as music, art, and even electric vehicles, depend on the underlying technology. Chainalysis is the blockchain data platform. We provide data, products, services, and research to government agencies, financial institutions, and the digital asset industry more broadly. Through the use of our software, law enforcement has managed to take down the largest darknet markets, prevent the use of cryptocurrency for terrorist financing, and has prevented scams and investigated ransomware campaigns, as previously mentioned. Tens of thousands of cases and investigations have taken place on our platform by both public sector and private sector in the fight to remove illicit activity from cryptocurrencies. Our compliance software enables AML compliance for the digital asset industry to ensure their compliance with obligations under the Bank Secrecy Act. The blockchain's transparency and the permanence of the records that are contained within this allow us to root out this illicit activity. Law enforcement leverages the permanence of these records and its openness to take proactive steps in being able to investigate crimes without the need to serve subpoenas or have reporting requirements. When it comes to the use of sanctions as a tool for national security, OFAC has used the fact that there is compliance among the exchanges to foster a degree of sanctions across the Russian ecosystem. In September 2021, OFAC sanctioned SUEX and ChatEx, effectively removing these enablers as exchanges from the digital asset ecosystem. We at Chainalysis have also last week released a free and open sanctions screening tool for everyone in the industry to be able to screen against addresses that are listed on the OFAC SDN list. Just with any new technology, criminals have found innovative ways to exploit digital assets. As mentioned previously, illicit transactions only represent 0.15% of total transaction volume, as outlined in the Chainalysis Crypto Crime Report. I've included a much deeper analysis in my testimony, and happy to answer questions on it. The sanctions imposed on Russia demonstrate the power of investing in financial technology and the dominance of the dollar that we managed to achieve over the course of the 20th century. We need to make sure that we continue to invest in financial technology and build the financial rails that will be used by the globe in the 21st century. Embracing digital assets will help the US build this future. These new rails can be built in a way that encourages transparency and that not only protects our national security and public safety, but it actually enhances it. At the end of my testimony, I've written some recommendations about how regulators in Congress can act to reduce illicit activity in digital asset markets. And I'm very happy to answer questions.
Thank you, Mr. Levin. Mr. Mosier, please proceed. Welcome again to the committee.
Thank you, Chairman Brown. My grandfather was a justice of the peace in a small mining and steel town in western Pennsylvania. Sadly, he died long before I was born. But I treasure one of his 1953 election campaign cards. It says, endorsed by labor, an avowed enemy of communism. Those statements represent a sense of collective empowerment as well as vigilance that power can be oppressive. A desire to protect personal sovereignty led me to public service. After pro bono cases to help victims of domestic violence, I became a prosecutor at the Manhattan District Attorney and eventually deputy chief in the Department of Justice, investigating kleptocracy and the financing of human trafficking. Protecting self-determination, as enshrined in the Constitution, is a critical part of public service. To that, when we speak of illicit finance, we must also not forget the defenders of democracy whose financing may be considered illicit to autocrats and invading armies. The same cryptographic capabilities discussed here today enabled secure, auditable humanitarian aid to 60,000 healthcare workers in Venezuela under a repressive regime. No doubt the regime there considered its subversive illicit finance, but to the White House and Treasury who approved it, it was cryptographically secure humanitarian aid. As we debate risks of technology based on cryptography, it's critical to remember that encryption has protected and reflected our democratic values for years. Likewise, in the past few weeks, tens of millions of dollars worth of cryptocurrency were donated to Ukraine, faster and more aid than the UN provided. With the transparency of government-identified wallets on a public ledger, far more accountability than the UN's oil for food scandal. A few observations about ransomware in particular. Ransomware dates back to 1989, 2 decades before the emergence of Bitcoin. Yes, Bitcoin has become a preferred payment method because of speed and perceived anonymity. However, public ledgers offer law enforcement significant visibility and investigative benefits over opaque international banking. We saw this with the recovery of $2.3 million from the Colonial Pipeline attackers. The increase in ransomware has more to do with other developments. First, the advent of ransomware as a service, making kits widely available regardless of coding skills and drastically reducing barriers to entry, and the use of double extortion, greatly increasing payouts by also threatening to expose stolen data, not just lock the computer. We also know from SolarWinds that there are plenty of malign actors driven by non-financial incentives. Over-attributing cybercrime to cryptocurrency misses critical causes and preventive measures that can be taken. Certainly, there's work to be done yet for Web3 to be safely accessible, but the early internet had a lot of fraud and exploits as well. Instead of shutting down the internet, we work persistently to find the balance while prioritizing risks and pathways to consensus and clarity. If you want to tangibly impact illicit finance, here are 3 concrete actions you can take. First, pass the budget that was due last October. 15 months after landmark AML modernization legislation, FinCEN and OFAC are without the roughly $74 million increase in personnel and technology, while more and more are demanded from it. Resource them for their current job before burdening them and industry with more unfunded mandates. Second, resource and expansively clarify the AML whistleblower program to empower crowdsourced leads related to corruption and abuse. Explicitly include any violation of money laundering, not just the BSA. Last, press FATF representatives to focus on regulatory arbitrage through baseline consistency across jurisdictions before adventuring into new rules. We know that the gaps are concentrated at a small group of foreign centralized exchanges. Help diligent U.S. exchanges by leveling the playing field before expanding the rules to mere developers in conflict with our Constitution. I'll close at that. Constitutional principles set the foundation for our country and our standing in the world. As we see in unified solidarity with Ukraine, principles are a key rallying point in the global battlefield of ideals. Thank you for this opportunity to advance our ideals today.
Thank you, Mr. Mosher. Mr. Chobanian is joining us remote. Mr. Chobanian, welcome.
Good day. So, yeah, you can hear me? I guess so. Yeah, good day. So my name is Michael Chobanian. I'm a founder of Kuna Exchange, and I'm also the president of Blockchain Association of Ukraine. So currently we serve more than 450,000 users. I would like to tell my story. You have my statement to read, but I would like to do a bit of storytelling. So on 24th of February, I woke up at 5 a.m. because I heard really loud noises, and my windows were shaking, my house was shaking, and I immediately understood that that's it, the war has started. So I woke up, I went up on the internet, I Googled, I saw the formal proof that the war has started. My kid woke up, my wife woke up, and they asked me what's happening. And I said, Russia has started war on us. And my kid asked, how? Because we have so many friends in Russia, how could this happen? And I couldn't give her an answer. So a few hours later, we had to leave my home. This is pretty much all I have left. A few sweaters, sneakers and jeans. And we had the same with the other probably 3 million of people. We had to flee towards Western Ukraine. So a couple of hours later, when we got to the Western Ukraine, I decided that we have to set up a fund in order to help my people, my army. I knew that the army was in terrible conditions in terms of supplies, comparing, well, considering that we were fighting the apparently second largest army in the world. So we set up a fund, and a few hours later, I was approached by the Minister of Digital Transformation, and we discussed that instead of setting up a few smaller funds, it's better to set up one big government fund in order to, first of all, give transparency, in order to speed up the process of buying all the vital goods for my people, for my army. And basically, we set up a fund, and now it's being run by both Ministry of Digital Transformation and by the Ministry of Defense. Right now, we already collected more than $50 million in equivalent. We are reaching for about $100 million. Mr. Chairman stated what exactly we bought with. This is just tiny fraction of what we bought. We also had the opportunity to supply finance to the cities like Mariupol, to Kharkiv, which are now enclosed and captured by Russians. The internet still works there, so we can supply crypto there. And with this crypto, people can buy food and you know, wherever it's required there. Our fund is, well, because it's run on my exchange, it's fully compliant with the current laws and regulations in Ukraine. That's why we're working with the government. Yesterday, the president has signed the bill, and now crypto is fully legal in Ukraine. In terms of sanctions, because Mr. Chairman and Vice Chairman, you also said about the sanctions. So the first thing that we did as the crypto community in Ukraine, we shut down all the ruble operations, because that was the big hole in the sanctions list. And sanctions really help, because that's how we fight with economic means. Unfortunately, not all crypto companies followed our lead. Namely, Binance still works with the ruble, and it's a big hole in the sanctions. So I'd like you to investigate more on this. Also, there was the note, Mr. Chairman, that Russians could use crypto to avoid sanctions. This is not exactly true. I'm the person who is behind all the numbers. I know how it happens. So it's impossible, physically impossible, to transfer large amounts of money from fiat into crypto. And again, even if they do, which is impossible, I said, there is nothing they can do with it. Their yachts are being arrested, their house is being arrested, they can't travel to the civilized world. So for them, it's just done numbers, which are pretty useless. But I have to stress this out, and I have to stress this out very clearly, that there is a lot of Russians in Russia and outside of Russia who rely on crypto. These people are basically the opposition to the Putin's regime, and we have to make sure that when you draft the laws that we don't actually, you know, don't kill this opposition within Russia that could actually help us bring down the regime. And the final, I'd like to read from actual my statement. So by concluding, I would like to thank U.S. Senate and U.S. people for the opportunity to stand here and speak with these vital issues. Our nation is internally grateful for all the help given to by our international friends. Namely, yesterday we received a news that a lot of weapons will be given by U.S. Country and by the U.K. and other European partners. I truly believe that the unprecedented global unity and support for Ukraine during this unmerited, unwanted, and unnecessary bloodshed can put an end to the Putin regime and terror and lead us to an even brighter future. Thank you, and Slava Ukraine.
Thank you, Mr. Shabanin, and best wishes to you and your family. Mr. Stansberry, from remote, I believe, from North Carolina.
Chairman Brown, Ranking Member Toomey, distinguished members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to testify today. I'm a senior fellow in the Center on Law, Ethics, and National Security at Duke Law School, where I teach primarily in the areas of cybercrime and national security. I spent more than 8 years as a federal prosecutor in the United States Attorney's Office for the Southern District of New York. Today, I've been asked to talk about the role of cryptocurrencies in illicit activity and also the challenges facing law enforcement. So I'll begin with some context. Criminals have always sought to take advantage of new forms of technology to facilitate illegal activity. Over the last two decades, the pace at which they've done so has increased dramatically as the internet, social media, smartphones, and other innovations have changed the way we communicate. As a prosecutor, I saw digital communication like social media and encrypted messaging apps revolutionize the way that terrorist organizations recruit members and carry out operations. And of course, drug traffickers and criminals of all types also adopted these technologies to further their criminal conduct. So in similar ways, cryptocurrency is changing the way that criminals finance illegal activities. So in some ways, we've been here before, but in other ways, cryptocurrencies present new and distinct challenges. Because they are decentralized, easy to use, and hold the promise of at least some level of anonymity, cryptocurrencies can act as magnets for illicit activity. Cryptocurrency is now a multi-billion dollar business for criminals. It is used in connection with virtually every type of crime: child exploitation, human trafficking, extortion, fraud, you name it. Perhaps nowhere is cryptocurrency's role more vivid than in ransomware attacks. As many Americans know all too well, ransomware is no longer just a problem for U.S. businesses. It's a serious threat to our public safety and our national security. Look no further than the Colonial Pipeline attack last year, which caused fuel shortages throughout the Southeast United States. But that was only one incident among many. Hospitals, school districts, city governments, all of them are being victimized by this modern day hostage scheme. Cryptocurrency is a defining feature of modern ransomware, and the attraction for ransomware criminals is the same for other criminals: obscurity. Cryptocurrency ransom payments can often pass through multiple layers involving different entities, including entities outside regulated markets. Criminals employ a variety of methods along the way to hide their tracks, and I explain some of those methods in my written testimony. Some of these same methods can be used by criminals who use cryptocurrency to launder proceeds or hide illicit assets without traditional intermediaries. Even the cryptocurrency market itself is providing new opportunities for crime. Wallets and exchanges have become targets for theft and fraud. Criminals both steal money directly and also engage in scams to defraud innocent investors in cryptocurrency. In short, cryptocurrency-related crime is here and it's growing. And we should be clear that the threat is not just from ordinary criminals. Rogue nation states like North Korea have increasingly turned to cryptocurrency theft and other crimes to help finance their regimes. I'd now like to just say a few words about the challenges for prosecutors and law enforcement. Law enforcement is getting much better at tracing digital assets used to commit and cover up criminal activity. With the help of forensic analysis and know your customer information from regulated entities, law enforcement can sometimes shine a light on an otherwise opaque world. Last year, DOJ recovered a substantial portion of the $4.4 million in ransomware payments made in connection with the Colonial Pipeline attack. And just last month, DOJ recovered a record $3.6 billion in cryptocurrency allegedly related to a 2016 hack. These are promising and welcome developments. But we should not be too quick to conclude that tracking down the criminals using cryptocurrency is always easy or even always possible. Even with the latest analytics, a single investigation can be resource intensive and take years. The hardest part of a cyber-related prosecution can often be demonstrating what investigators sometimes refer to as hands on the keyboard. Prosecutors have to demonstrate beyond a reasonable doubt that an identifiable person was behind a particular act. Digital clues from cryptocurrency transfers can be invaluable, but they don't provide all of the answers about who is behind the criminal activity. When my colleagues and I investigated international money laundering cases, we often connected dots because of information made available by institutions that followed their compliance obligations. That kind of information is sometimes available in today's cryptocurrency market, but too often it is not. Not all platforms comply with existing regulations, and many operate in jurisdictions beyond the reach of the United States law enforcement agents. At the end of the day, an investigation is only as successful as the information and resources available. Blockchain technology does offer fascinating possibilities, and I look forward to seeing how it develops. But we should also recognize the role that cryptocurrency is playing in criminal activity. Only then can we take steps necessary to protect our health, our safety, and our national security. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stansberry. I'll begin the question, Mr. Levin, but first, Mr. Mosher, you mentioned request for the dollars. The president signed the bill a couple of days ago with $50 million. Significant number, obviously, to combat money laundering. So your request was granted. That.
Thank you. I won't take credit for that.
Oh, go ahead. Mr. Levin, you noted that in 2021, the volume of illicit crypto transactions grew something like at least $14 billion, a pretty big number. You explained the methods criminals use to conceal their transactions, new tactics like chain hopping or mixers to obscure the trail of funds. These are the strategies you're using right now. Tell us, if you would, what are the emerging ways that illicit actors are exploiting digital assets to avoid detection and obscure their identities? What are their next moves that you expect?
Thank you, Chairman. So when it comes to these types of obfuscation techniques or any sort of anonymizing techniques that criminals pursue, this is a very cat and mouse type situation where Chainalysis, the business, we research these techniques and stay, you know, oftentimes one step ahead of these criminal actors. And so you mentioned chain hopping and mixing. I think the largest gap is truly on the, you know, offshore exchanges that you also mentioned in being able to cash out these types of transactions. You'll note in the crypto crime report that we put forward, there's a concentration of cash outs by ransomware actors at only a few destinations. And so if law enforcement could focus in on those, we could get ahead of some of the illicit flows that you're concerned about.
Yeah. Thank you. Mr. Stansberry, it seems digital assets have enabled and emboldened whole new types of criminal activity. Look at ransomware that you discussed. There are now criminal groups that license out ransomware software to other hackers, or take dark web markets where people can buy and sell drugs and stolen credit card numbers using crypto. How have criminals used features of digital assets to invent new kinds of crime? And as you answer that, what kinds of criminal conduct are built around these cryptocurrencies?
Sure. Thank you, Senator. I think I would divide it into a couple of different categories. As you mentioned, cryptocurrency has made some existing crimes easier, and has changed the nature of some crimes, like extortion. Ransomware has been around for a while, but cryptocurrency has changed the way the way extortion looks, and ransomware is a perfect example of that. Cryptocurrency is now the currency for ransomware. The FBI director, a senior director in the FBI mentioned just this year that cryptocurrency is the exclusive medium for exchanges for ransomware. So in some ways, it's made things easier for existing crimes and changed the nature of those crimes. In other ways, it's provided new opportunities for new crimes. The DOJ crypto enforcement framework, cryptocurrency enforcement framework from a couple of years ago, I think does a nice job of outlining that and framing it. But I would say that anytime you build a new financial ecosystem, it presents new opportunities for criminals, obviously. And so that means that exchanges can be hacked by North Korea. It means that wallets can be hacked. It means that there are new scam opportunities. And we've seen a variety of those scams increase in frequency over the last year. In fact, Chainalysis does a nice job of describing some of those techniques. So it both can contribute to existing crime and also create new opportunities.
Thank you. Mr. Chobanian, the 2022 crypto crime report from Chainalysis pinpoints Russia as a leader in illicit criminal activity using digital currency. Many ransomware groups like Evil Corp, that's actually what they call themselves, are based there. Moscow's a hub, as you know, for crypto money laundering. Why is it important that we crack down on Russia's cybercrime that uses digital assets?
Very good question. Well, obviously cybercrime is not good, but I'll have to stress out one thing. Think of crypto as energy. For example, nuclear energy. You can use nuclear for good to create cheap energy, or you can create bombs with the nuclear energy. So same with crypto. You can use it for good or you can use it for bad. It depends who uses it and how he uses it. So in terms of hackers, and especially Russian hackers, well, I think that pretty much they are stuck in Russia right now, and there is nothing that they can do with this crypto, as I said before. I mean, they're sitting in a city where you can't even go to McDonald's, you can't buy Pepsi, you can't buy any of the Western world goods and services. So the only thing they can do is just look at the numbers. So right now, I don't see that as a big problem, but it's a potentially, could be a big problem if something happens to Russia, not the way that we plan in Ukraine.
Thank you, Senator Toomey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chobanian, first let me just say our heart breaks for you and your family like it does for the several million Ukrainians that have been forced from their homes by this outrageous and completely unjustified brutal attack by Russia, and we're particularly grateful that you've taken the time to join us despite the experience you are going through. I wonder if you could just tell us in a simple way for laymen to understand. You mentioned that you're on track, you're hopefully going to raise $100 million from donations from people all around the world who want to help Ukraine. Why is this being done through crypto? Why aren't people just sending dollars and yen and euro and other currencies?
Very good question. Thank you. The banking system in your country is totally different to my country. So for you, it's easier. Well, it's easy just to press two numbers and you can send any amount to other participant that you want. With the crypto and Ukraine, it's slightly different. First problem that we're solving is urgency. So in order for US dollars to actually land on Ukrainian bank accounts, it takes at least one day if we are lucky, but usually it takes 2 days. If it's a Friday afternoon, you have to wait till Monday. For my country, which is fighting right now with bare hands, time is the vital thing. So with the crypto, which works 24/7, we receive money instantly and we can spend money instantly. By money, I'm speaking in the broader terms. So yeah, that's the key thing. And the other thing is that with crypto, we can attract donations from pretty much any place in the world, even countries which don't have access to banking, but they have crypto, like in Africa or in Asia. It's speed, urgency, and ease of use.
And it's inexpensive, isn't it?
It depends. Here it depends which currency you're sending it. So Bitcoin and Ether is slightly expensive, but again, it's like $10, $20, maximum $50. But at this point, it doesn't really matter. Here, what we're fighting for is speed. The faster we buy the helmets, the faster we buy the bulletproof vests, the faster we buy the first aid kits, the more people I can save in my country. So here, I'm praying just for crypto because it's so fast.
And given the disruptions to daily life in Ukraine, has there been an increase in the use of crypto as a medium of exchange? Are ordinary people using crypto to buy ordinary things in some cases? Because, of course, that's not common in the United States.
Well, even before the war, Ukraine was number one country per capita in terms of crypto wallets and crypto usage. Now it's probably doubled that. The reason for that is you cannot buy US dollars on the bank accounts right now because National Bank closed that option on the day of the war. So if you want to buy something abroad, the only option that you have, and if you have like local currency hryvnia on the bank account, or you have cash in US dollars in Ukraine, or you have, that's it, the two options. So the only option to actually buy something abroad, you need US dollars and you cannot buy them. With the crypto, you can actually buy USDT, which is a token which backed one-to-one to US dollar. You can buy that with local currency. You can use that to pay for the helmets in Europe or in US. The transaction takes about 10 minutes. And that's it. And that's the only option for the small and medium businesses and for regular people like me.
Thank you very much. This question is for both Mr. Mosier and Mr. Levin. So we all want to make sure we've got the tools to find the bad guys, and there are bad guys out there. For a very long time, we've had a reporting requirement for financial institutions that sort of is this massive dragnet, like require banks to report every single transaction over $10,000. Now, we know, we've long known, that the vast overwhelming majority of those transactions are perfectly legitimate. But we didn't have a way of sort the good from the bad, so we report them all. And we have this expensive, inefficient mechanism for this over-reporting in the hopes that, well, maybe, you know, we'll at least sweep up the bad guys too. With crypto, we have a whole new kind of technology, it seems to me. And I guess what I'm wanting, would like you to comment on is, rather than apply the old, outdated, like 50-year-old technology to crypto, should we be thinking about using the tools that crypto avails us to zero in on the likely problematic transactions rather than having this universal reporting requirement that sweeps in perfectly legitimate transactions? If you could both comment on that, I'd appreciate it.
Thank you, Senator Toomey. Yeah, no, I think it raises a really important question and something that we struggled with at FinCEN, both from a resource and a technology perspective, and also with protecting personal data. And I think there's another piece of that, which is when we collect data, we're regularly asked, I think legitimately by the public and by Congress, okay, what have you done with that that was worth the burden? And in fact, every rulemaking requires a burden assessment on industry for that. And I think what we struggled with was getting the tools and the technology to be able to sort through the data that we had. Indeed, there's still continue to do that. And we're always conscientious that if we're creating new reporting requirements, will we be able to use it and will be able to use it fast enough? So I think given as what Mr. Levin will surely talk to about the capabilities and what we've, I think, all discussed in terms of the public transparency, that the critical piece right now is it's on a public ledger. We don't really need you to send stuff in. What we need are the tools to sort through that efficiently and connect it across data. It's already actually exceptionally clean data because it's structured data. It's numbers. It's alphanumerics. It's not the old days of faxed machine and people write into the wrong format and we can't sort it. So it's actually quite good data. It's just the ability to use it.
Thank you, Senator Toomey, and agree sort of with the premise of the question. The problem with a reporting requirement with a fixed number means that becomes a difficult thing to change over time and creates sort of a deluge of information around something that seems fairly arbitrary in nature. When it comes to the blockchain, there is a complete set of records out there for everyone to look at that actually also updates in real time. So there is no waiting for reporting to happen. And so not only are you able to, you know, access it, you're able to access it faster than you would otherwise be able to in a reporting sense, and then actually being able to sift through what is illicit activity from what is, you know, regular commerce is much easier in a cryptocurrency context than in traditional finance, where you're looking for behavioral patterns. And so, you know, I think when it comes to, you know, thinking about regulating the digital asset economy, we have to take into account those unique attributes of the technology and think about, sort of, as my esteemed colleague here said, you know, the scarce resources that there are in government agencies to actually look at this and invest in the technology to be able to have that real-time oversight of the sector.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Menendez from New Jersey is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have raised concerns in the past with Iran's practice of mining cryptocurrency in order to launder its sanctioned oil and natural gas reserves into cash, because the main cost associated with mining cryptocurrency is energy. I worry that the Russian government will also look to mining as a way to evade sanctions. According to the Cambridge Bitcoin Electricity Consumption Index, Russia accounts for 13.6% of all Bitcoin mining as measured by energy consumption. So they certainly have the infrastructure for such activities. So, Mr. Stansberry, are there tools that would allow financial institutions and regulators to prevent use of mining to avoid sanctions?
There are tools available to regulators, I think largely it's on the enforcement front. You're right that Iran has successfully mined cryptocurrency to its advantage. There's also, a lot of reporting about North Korea that has turned to cryptocurrency to fund its regime. So it's a huge problem. But I think that, we need to look to on the enforcement front, what are these nation states, how are these nation states able to bypass sanctions? How are they able to convert the cryptocurrency that they are mining? Because they are moving it across borders and somehow converting it to a medium that they can use. So that I think is where most of the problem lies.
Uh-huh. And Mr. Levin and Mr. Chobanian, what's your understanding of the links between Russian miners and the Russian government?
Happy to go first. Michael, you can go first.
Thank you. So I can say that probably there is none because Russian miners are just regular people, the businessmen who are, doing it for principles of, crypto because they believe in this technology, or especially if they want to earn money, that's what they do. But again, when you talk about sanctions on the government level, what kind of sums are we talking about? If we're talking about billions, then I can answer you right now, it's impossible to substitute Bitcoin or any other cryptocurrency for US dollars on a government level. You cannot transfer that easily, a couple of billions of dollars, without anyone noticing on the physical level. So I would like to stress this point. So it's not an issue of the big numbers. And smaller numbers, it's not about buying oil or buying weapons or buying anything else with the small numbers of in US dollars. Thank you.
Interesting.
Yeah, Senator, I would agree with what Mr. Chobanian said. I think the only other thing to raise is that, it has been possible for US law enforcement and the intelligence community to actually identify and attribute Russian government activity in cybercrime cases when it comes to the issues of ransomware, hacking, other forms of financial crime. And so, it's the case that we need to further the capabilities of those agencies to get close to the operatives and the operations of Russia in this domain to continue to understand the evolving picture.
Uh-huh. Now, there's a difference between the Russian government and Russian oligarchs. The government's relationship with exchanges, both foreign and domestic, is going to be an increasingly key element in enforcing sanctions going forward. We're seeing with the current crisis in Ukraine that law enforcement is relying on exchanges themselves to screen users and block sanctioned targets. Mr. Stansberry, what are the risks to U.S. persons and institutions of trading with exchanges in Russia and other jurisdictions with poor monitoring and know your customer rules?
I think one of the risks is scam, fraud, and theft. There's a degree of risk that any consumer is taking when they place their investment or their money into the cryptocurrency ecosystem. And in a high risk environment like that, I think that is the one of the chief concerns, particularly as cryptocurrency grows in popularity and more less sophisticated investors get into the market.
Mm-hmm. And finally, Mr. Levin, your firm estimates that of all the ransomware payments made in 2020, 15% of them carried a risk of sanctions violations. So essentially, victims of ransomware attacks are increasingly finding themselves targeted by sanctioned entities, and therefore victims that make ransom payments in cryptocurrency may themselves be committing sanctions violations. How should we in Congress think about addressing this problem without undermining the efficiency of our sanctions tools?
Thank you, Senator. It's a delicate balance between the issue of sanctioning and disrupting the cybercrime activity and raising the deterrent against such attacks. And so, you know, I think the effective sanctions against entities like Evil Corp that have been sort of behind these types of attacks has meant that there are, you know, fewer firms that are willing to actually pay those ransoms, which does actually reduce the incentive by which they have to attack our population. And so, you know, I think that, you know, it's another example of how effective sanctions can be when it comes to, you know, disrupting activity that we are worried about for our public safety.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Menendez, Senator Hagerty from Tennessee is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Happy St. Patrick's Day to everybody today. Over the past year, law enforcement has recovered billions in stolen crypto. All of this has been done in an ecosystem that has been often described as anonymous, illicit, the Wild West, in fact, of illicit finance. But in my view, it's inconsistent with the architecture of blockchain technology because most cryptocurrencies are built on a public ledger that makes the chain of ownership visible. And by extension, it makes it traceable to any token's existence at any point. Mr. Levin, I'll start with you. Cryptocurrencies are pseudo-anonymous, right? The wallet address themselves don't identify the owners. But with the proper tools and proper legal authority, what capabilities exist to actually track and identify illicit actors in cryptocurrency such as Bitcoin?
Thank you, Senator. And it's an important point to make because it's often conceived that cryptocurrency is not as transparent as it actually is. And so, you know, when it comes to having the necessary tools in place, Chainalysis, what we do is we map all the transactions that occur in cryptocurrencies to the entities and services that people are using mm-hmm. to conduct that activity. And so the fact that all of the industry and all of law enforcement and the regulatory authorities can all have access to that same information about what services and what entities are behind these transactions, you know, that allows us to take unprecedented steps in being able to collaborate on weeding out illicit activity. And you point out that, you know, the government has also managed to seize, you know, record sums of money from these cases in a world in which people thought that it was anonymous and that it was, you know, unable to be seized. So, you know, law enforcement can have these types of successes in this environment.
I think it's interesting when you compare cryptocurrency to cash, on the other hand. And if you think about cash is fully anonymous. It's untraceable. There's no underlying record of the chain of ownership with cash. And no one knows where a particular $100 bill may have been, whose hands it may have passed through, or how many hands it may have passed through. So it seems to me that an individual that wants to break the law without being traced would probably find cash a more attractive alternative than cryptocurrency. Do you agree that cash is less traceable than cryptocurrency?
Indeed, Senator. Cash is far less traceable than cryptocurrency for the point that you point out. The other thing about this is that, you know, it's the case that, you know, law enforcement also has the permanence of the record mm-hmm. When it comes to cryptocurrency. The cases far back in the past can be solved based on information that is collected in the future. The problem with a cash transaction is that when I hand you a $10 bill, you know, that's a completely ephemeral event, and that is never captured forever. And so, you know, prosecutors are able to actually leverage the permanence of the blockchain to have conclusive evidence of, you know, the type of illicit activity that we're worried about, which is another deterrent against criminals using it.
Yeah, I completely agree. Yet, when you go back to thinking about cash, I don't hear anybody saying that we ought to outlaw the use of cash. Do you hear that? I don't think so. In reality, the mischaracterization that crypto is the Wild West of illicit finance, you know, I'd hate to see that be used in a way to open the door to drop a morass of regulation on an industry that poses so much potential for America and for our competitive advantage. Mr. Levin, I'd like to continue to follow up. There's a lot of discussion here on Capitol Hill that Congress needs to craft legislation to make it harder to use cryptocurrency to evade sanctions. One of your firm's specialties is tracking cryptocurrency transactions and monitoring potentially illicit activity. So hypothetically, how would someone trying to evade sanctions convert their cryptocurrency holdings into fiat without interfacing with the banking system?
So, Senator, the question about how to move from cryptocurrency into traditional finance requires a traditional financial institution. Mm-hmm. And there are these interfaces that have been, you know, the subject of, you know, anti-money laundering legislation globally. And so, you know, I think that to your question, you cannot move from cryptocurrency into traditional finance without interfacing with one of those institutions that has the regulatory obligations that protect us against its abuse.
The sanctionable regulatory obligations, yes. just to be clear. Mr. Mosier, just very quickly, I think that there's been a lot of attention paid to the possibility that digital assets are undermining America's sanctions regime. And I'd like to just get your perspective on what Congress can or should do to help authorities and firms in the crypto space more effectively fight illicit finance.
Thank you, Senator Hagerty. Yeah, I think the most thing that Congress can do is help provide clarity. There are a lot of crypto firms out there that would like to be certain in that they are complying with the law. And I think there's a lot of debate, particularly across the SEC and the CFTC, about what exactly is needed to be in compliance. And so... And who's in charge of compliance. Yeah. And I think there's a lot of people that really want to have a business model that's successful for everybody. And by the way, that means a safe financial system that people feel comfortable putting their money into. And they're just looking to know what exactly should I do to... What's the standard and what should I meet?
I appreciate your point on certainty and clarity. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thanks, Senator Harry. Senator Tester from Montana is recognized. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you all for being here, both virtually and in person. I'm going to start out with a question that's already been probably answered, but I just want to hear it from your lips to my ears. And that is, do you think Putin and the oligarchs are using cryptocurrency to get around sanctions? Yes or no?
Sorry, is that a question for me, Senator?
It's for you first, Mr. Levin. I'm going to go down the list, but very quickly.
Thank you, Senator. So we have not seen evidence of Russia or Putin systematically using cryptocurrencies to evade sanctions at this moment in time.
Okay. Mr. Mosier, would you like to respond to that?
Thank you, Senator Tester. No, in fact, I will quote my successor as counselor to the Deputy Secretary of the Treasury, who recently said, "You can't flip a switch overnight and run a G20 economy on cryptocurrency. There just isn't the liquidity."
Okay. And Mr. Shabanian?
I would say no. And the reason for that is they tried to ban crypto for the long, long time. And the only time when they said that probably they should reconsider their decision is after the war. So I would say most definitely no.
Thank you. And Mr. Stansbury, do you have an opinion on that?
I would just add that I think there might be a difference between individuals engaging in that activity and whether it's occurring at scale. I think the possibility is certainly there, and which is why DOJ has recently stood up a task force to address just that issue.
Okay. And so, Mr. Levin, I think that you pointed out that the reason why crypto is safe is because it's totally trackable, correct?
The inherent transparency does provide advantages, yes.
So we had folks that came after the Colonial Pipeline with ransomware, and we got 85% of the money back. Why didn't we get 100% if it's totally trackable?
That's a great question. I think when it comes to the ability to see the money versus seize the money is a distinction which is not always the case. There was 100% degree of transparency about where the money was actually going, but in terms of actually the operation to be able to recover the funds, that is not always 100% possible.
Mr. Stansbury, the question for you is, in your statement, you had talked about the fact that it's very difficult to connect people with the payments when it comes to illegal activity. Is that pretty much what you said? I was just curious.
Yes, Senator. Thank you. I was making the point that it can sometimes be difficult to connect that sort of life, the last two dots in terms of linking cryptocurrency payments to specific individuals. Firms like Chainalysis can do a fantastic job of looking at patterns and giving law enforcement a lot of tools to follow those financial transactions on the blockchain, but ultimately you have to connect those things to real people, and that's not always available just through analytics.
All right, and so if you can't connect people with payments, how can you hold people accountable for illegal activity?
There are a lot of tools at law enforcement's disposal, but things have to go right. I think a good example, is the recent seizure announced by DOJ last week, the record seizure of cryptocurrency payments. Now, those are allegations, so I want to be careful and say that. But they worked for 5 or 6 years to connect the dots. And even though they were able to identify certain payment patterns by these individuals who had were in possession of Bitcoin that came from the hack of an exchange back in 2016, it really took traditional law enforcement tools like search warrants, and it also depended on the fact that, for example, the defendants were living in plain view in New York City, and they were using cloud storage accounts that were within the reach of U.S. Law enforcement, so they could search warrants on those accounts. So it's really fact-dependent, Senator, on whether law enforcement is going to be able to get that last piece of the puzzle.
Well, I certainly appreciate all your perspectives, and I can tell you that the reason, at least from my perspective, why cash is a whole lot different cryptocurrencies, it takes a lot of suitcases to transfer the kind of cash that you're talking about with what I believe is a simple press of a button in crypto. I think this is a great hearing. I think that there's far more information to be fleshed out here, and I want to thank the chairman for holding it.
Thanks, Sir Tester. Senator Smith of Minnesota is recognized.
Thank you very much, and I agree, Senator Tester. This is a very interesting hearing, and I'm grateful for our panelists for being here today. So as we focus on controlling the illicit use of crypto, there's this discussion about how we should regulate it and how we should regulate digital assets in order to control the bad guys. And so to a certain extent, it seems like what we're trying to do is to fit this new technology into existing regulatory frameworks. And, so for example, should we think of digital assets as commodities in the jurisdiction of the CFTC, or should we think about it as security in the jurisdiction of the SEC? And maybe neither of those frameworks are the right way of thinking about it. But it seems to me that without some regulatory framework, without a cop on the beat, so to speak, we're at a great disadvantage in terms of cracking down on illicit use. So I'm not advocating for one framework versus the other, but I'm wondering, Mr. Levin, I'm going to ask you this. I guess the first question is, what impact is there when we don't, with a lack of a clear regulator or regulatory framework, what impact does that have? Let me ask you that first.
Thank you, Senator, and I share the concern that you have when it comes to the clarity point and the impact of that on, really the U.S. and the industry in general is that there is less funding available. There are fewer innovators actually going to work on, this type of technology inside this jurisdiction, which gives rise to the possibility that the financial rails that are going to govern the 21st century are going to be built outside of this country and beyond, our ability to have real insight and the records of what is actually happening in these types of new payment systems. And so, I think that the twofold is that we're going to lose out on a very large economic promise, which is that this is an economic industry that will create dynamism in this economy. But secondly, we may lose out on the national security risk that we lose some visibility into what could be conducted on these rails that if they are built outside of this country.
So if we are building a regulatory framework that becomes a standard, then we have by definition more national security benefit because we understand what those standards are, we have more control.
Yeah, that would be correct, Senator.
Right. And it's sort of a truism of business in general, broadly speaking, when they think about regulation, that they will say, I just want to know what the rules are so that I can follow them, and I want an even playing field. The good businesses, businesses that are operating above board. It seems like that would be pretty much the same view if you look at digital assets and crypto.
Yes, Senator. Indeed. So the industry in this country has done a lot of work on collaborating with regulators on the different proposals that are being put in place. They participate extensively in public consultation on this type of regulation. And there have been a lot of efforts on educating regulators, policymakers on really the unique attributes of cryptocurrencies and what potential it has for really novel types of oversight. And I think one of the points here is that the transparency of cryptocurrencies and the availability of the data means that there can be greater oversight for these financial regulators in novel ways that actually this committee has been very focused on achieving in broader financial services, and actually setting up a regulatory architecture that can endure over time, that costs less for business and is more effective.
And Mr. Salisbury, to the same extent that having an understandable regulatory framework can create a fair and even playing field for good actors, how do you respond to this if you're trying to figure out on how to crack down on the bad actors? What impact does the lack of a clear regulator or a clear regulatory framework have if you are trying to take advantage of the system, like we know some are?
Thank you, Senator. I think the lack of clarification, I think, lends itself, obviously, to the sort of murky situation that we have now, where we clearly have a group of exchanges that working in the cryptocurrency world that are trustworthy, doing the right things, and that are providing the kind of know your customer information and things that are helpful to prosecutors and investigators. But the lack of clarity also contributes, I think, to a very large ecosystem of institutions that are working outside that. And so I think the clarity will help, but also enforcing the Bank Secrecy Act more aggressively, could help. And drafting maybe tighter rules on money transmitters like cryptocurrency and exchanges and payment providers. I think that there's been some movement like that. But those things help, right, on the enforcement front, because it helps push people towards the legitimate exchanges, I think.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Senator Warren from Massachusetts is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The cryptocurrency market has exploded over the past few years, with the volume of crypto transactions reaching nearly $16 trillion last year. That's up about 600% just from 2020. Now, most of that growth has been driven by speculation and gambling, but we also know that crypto provides a new payment option for criminals and cheats. And it's how those who attack our systems with ransomware collect their money with the least risk that they will be caught. In fact, according to one of our witnesses who's here with us today, about 3/4 of the money collected in ransomware attacks last year went to Russia-linked actors. So Russians certainly know how to run illegal scams through crypto. And we know that other countries have used crypto to evade sanctions. Mr. Levin, your company tracks illicit finance in crypto. Do you know which countries have already used crypto to evade sanctions?
Thank you, Senator, for the question. It's an incredibly important issue and something that we spend a lot of time researching and detecting, actually. So when it comes to sanctions evasion, the transparency of the blockchain actually does...
Excuse me. My question was, do you know the 3 countries that have already used crypto in order to evade financial sanctions?
We have detected the use of cryptocurrency in Venezuela, Iran, and North Korea.
Okay. And just last week, FinCEN, the federal agency responsible for identifying financial crimes, issued a warning that in light of the sanctions against Russia, quote, sanctioned persons, illicit actors, and their related networks or facilitators may attempt to use crypto and anonymizing tools to evade U.S. sanctions and protect their assets around the globe, end quote. Even so, the crypto industry claims that Russians cannot use crypto to hide their wealth because the $3 trillion crypto market is too small and too transparent for that to work. So let's test that out just a little bit. Mr. Levin, let's consider one of Putin's cronies who already has $1 billion or so in crypto that he wants to hide from the governments that are enforcing sanctions on oligarchs. Now, can this oligarch make it harder to trace his money if he hops from one blockchain to another, if he deposits those tokens into a couple of wallets that don't require him to provide identifying information, and if he uses a mixing service that launders his money with other people's money?
Thank you, Senator. So the scenario that you describe, where an oligarch has $1 billion to be able to launder, requires significant amounts of liquidity to be able to obfuscate that amount of money through the use of cryptocurrency. In fact, you know, many times we've been able to identify...
So, I'm sorry, let me just remind you of what my question was again. What I'm asking is about the tools that are available. Now, he may have to break it up into multiple pieces of, who knows, $100 million at a crack. But the question I'm asking is, does hopping from one blockchain to another, does depositing tokens in a couple of wallets that don't require him to provide identifying information, and does using a mixing service all make it easier for him to hide his money?
So, Senator, the answer to that question is no, because the chain hopping that occurs, you need to actually provide the tokens, which in a transparent way that allows you to move across blockchains. We've actually got software that allows
you to... So you don't think chain hopping makes it any easier to hide your money? How about depositing tokens in wallets that don't require identifying information?
You can always split the money up into wallets that don't require...
And that would help hide the money. And how about using a mixing service?
But that doesn't remove the record of where the money actually sits.
But the question I'm asking... is, does it make it harder to track the money?
No, so it doesn't make it harder to track the money.
And
because
using
there
a mixing
is,
service, you're telling me, doesn't make it harder to launder money?
The daily liquidity value of mixing services globally is about $30 million.
So and you might so have to do this day by day?
And we have done extensive work in tracking large sums of money through mixers that have led to the arrests of people and the disruption of their activity.
You know, I'm actually a little surprised by your answer, since you charge a lot of money to untangle and track assets through the system, and the system keeps developing more ways to obscure that money, and that's part of what you advertise. But I want to get on to a question with Mr. Stansbury. You're a former assistant U.S. attorney who's led major cybercrime and money laundering investigations. So let me ask you, is it possible that the oligarch, my hypothetical oligarch, could now buy and sell some of the things that he wants, diamonds, art, maybe even real estate, without ever needing to put his money into the formal banking system, which also would make it harder for law enforcement to catch him?
Thank you, Senator. Yes, it's theoretically possible in today's market. Obviously, it's hard, but at least if he's able to go to a friendly jurisdiction and use cryptocurrency exchanges or some other platform that's not in compliance with internationally recognized anti-money laundering standards, as you've suggested, that is possible. There's also some reporting recently of jurisdictions being friendly for some purchases of real estate and other items through cryptocurrency.
So no one can argue that Russia can evade all sanctions by moving all its assets into crypto. But for Putin's oligarchs who are trying to hide, you know, a billion or two, a few hundred million, crypto looks like a pretty good option. And that's why I'm introducing today my Digital Asset Sanctions Compliance Enhancement Act, along with 9 members of the Banking Committee, including the chairman of the Senate Armed Services Committee, the chairman of the Senate Intelligence Committee, and the chairman of the Defense Appropriations Subcommittee, and several other senators. This is a bill that would authorize the president to sanction foreign crypto firms that are doing business with sanctioned Russian entities, and authorize the Secretary of the Treasury to act. Thank you for being indulgent, for letting me run over on time. I appreciate it.
Senator Lamas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate you're appearing here today. Thank you for joining us. Mr. Mosher, I want to ask you a straightforward question based on your law enforcement experience at the Treasury Department. If an investigator was forced to choose between investigating an illicit finance case involving cash or digital assets, which do you believe most would choose and why?
Thank you for the question, Senator Lummis. I think there's no question, and this comes from time at the Department of Justice and also being the head of enforcement at OFAC. It is far, far faster to get to the critical point that you need to dig deeper with cryptocurrency, given the nature of the public ledger. This is for several reasons. One, you have a public immutable ledger. So if you take the example of when OFAC designates an address, within hours, mathematical heuristics from Chainalysis, TRM, Elliptic, all these tools out there are quickly building out all the public ledger networks that are associated with that address through co-spending and other relatively mathematically certain ways of at least knowing what the association is. In the fiat world, you see an address, and for the next 3 years, you do mutual legal assistance treaties and hope that you get something back. You guess what regional banks might be involved based on the customers you think it's going to be and send subpoenas and hope that they come back. And then you manually try to associate addresses with entities. It's just exponentially faster.
Thank you. Is it Levin or Levin?
Senator, I respond to either, but it's Levin.
Levin. Okay, thank you. Chainalysis found that approximately 0.15% of all digital asset transactions were related to illicit finance in 2021. Is that correct?
Yes, 0.15%, yes.
The United Nations recently estimated that money laundered in the traditional financial system is between $800 billion and $2 trillion in U.S. dollars a year. So how does that compare with digital assets?
Thanks, Senator. So just to put the like-for-like comparison, it's important to look at the percentages as estimates. And so, you know, in the traditional financial sector and the OECD and the IMF and others, estimate somewhere between 2 to 5% of world, you know, financial flows are related to money laundering and illicit flows. You know, comparing that to the 0.15% when it comes to cryptocurrencies.
So clearly, cryptocurrencies have a smaller illicit use than fiat currencies.
Yes, Senator, that is correct.
Okay. Now, is Mr. Chobanian online? Oh, excellent. I have a question. Hi, Mr. Chobanian. I so appreciate your being here. I want to ask you about the record sums of money that the people of the world have donated to Ukraine using digital assets over the last few weeks. How long did it take for you to set up the infrastructure to begin accepting donations? And how long does it take for the Ukrainian government to begin to use those donations?
Thank you. So the setup was about 10 minutes. The hardest part was to actually put the addresses on the Twitter through, because we had to go through the bureaucracy of who is in charge of a Twitter account of Ukraine. And in terms of usage, the minute the crypto landed on these addresses, the government could use them. So immediately, no bureaucracy here.
So how long and how burdensome would it have been for you to accept donations using traditional forms of payment from other countries, including wire transfers?
If I can remember and recall correctly, I think it took National Bank about 10 days to post the IBAN and the rest of the correspondent addresses needed to wire the money into Ukraine.
So digital assets have made an important difference to the defense of Ukraine. Is that true?
I can answer it differently. We actually received the first humanitarian aid on the second day after we received the first crypto. So we spent it immediately, and the next day the goods were in Ukraine, less than 24 hours. Is that the answer?
That is the answer. And I'm so pleased you were willing to take the time to be us today, with us today, because while a lot of attention has been paid here in Congress to whether the Russians could use digital assets to evade sanctions, there's been very little attention paid to how much the existence of digital assets have benefited the Ukrainians in being able to get badly needed supplies. So I'm deeply grateful to all of our witnesses today. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Is Senator Warner with us remotely?
I am, Senator Toomey, I'm here.
Senator Warner is recognized.
Well, thank you. And I do appreciate you and the chairman holding this hearing. And I think there's a little bit of a conundrum here as somebody who's been looking at this issue for some time as chair of the Intelligence Committee. I'm not sure that kind of positing of this is an either or circumstance is the correct posit. I believe there are some value in digital assets. I think we need to continue to explore it. And, you know, candidly, I want to acknowledge Senator Lemus's last point with our witness from the Ukraine. This has been a way to move assets to the Ukrainian people in a relatively fast way, and I want to commend that. But I also want to start, and I'm actually proud to be one of the sponsors along with Senator Warren, because I am hugely concerned that because of some of this ease of transferring of assets that has helped the Ukrainian people, as we've seen from some of the press reports, and I won't relitigate the Reuters article, that same ease and frankly, lack of transparency has allowed and will allow Russian oligarchs, and I hope again that we move further and not just sanction the top oligarchs, but we ought to sanction the whole Russian Duma for being complicit with Putin's illegal invasion of Ukraine. But that same ease is allowing conversion of fiat currency to crypto, to then potentially buying properties in nations around the world that have accepted this. But I want to start with Mr. Stansberry, because on the whole question of ransomware, I respectfully disagree very strongly with Mr. Levin's analysis of not 0.15 in terms of illicit payments. And again, one of the reasons why we passed, and I appreciate everybody's support on this, a mandatory cyber reporting bill. We only get about a third of the cyber incidents being reported to the government that needs to be reported so we can share, frankly, with our private sector partners. But I can assure you, and we saw this with the Colonial Pipeline incident, I believe the volume of ransomware that's paid in crypto assets, Bitcoin, et cetera, is exponentially higher. You know, Mr. Stansfield, as a Stansberry, the continued growth and profitability of ransomware, do you see that connection to the ability and the liquidity brought about by cryptocurrencies and how that interaction? I think it is, again, much higher than what the other witnesses testified to.
Thank you, Senator Warner. I would agree. And in fact, I think the FBI and other agencies have indicated that ransomware incidents are much, much higher than all of those that we hear about and know about, obviously, because not all of them are reported. I think we have a lot of unknowns. And in terms of where the trends are going, I think that probably tells you a lot of what you need to know, right? Last year in October, in a FinCEN report, it was revealed that SARs filed in I think 2021 were projected in the first half of 2021 were projected to have a higher ransomware related transaction value than SARs filed in the previous 10 years combined. So I think the trend tells us that cryptocurrency works. The fact that it is the exclusive tool for ransomware actors, I think, tells us a lot. So I think I would look at that evidence as much as anything else.
And I completely agree with that. And again, I think one of the things that this new law will both have cyber incident reporting, but also there'll be some ransomware reporting. So we will have candidly better data. And the notion, frankly, that the Russian government in one effort did help us potentially identify some of the Colonial Pipeline ransomware criminals using crypto as their payment methodology, SureSec means the Russian government knows how to use this currency, knows how to use this payment method. And I think we need to make sure there is not the leakage of these sanctions. I think we all want to sanction the bad guys in Russia. I think we ought to broaden those sanctions. And I think the legislation, and I hope we'll be able to work through this and gain broader base support that Senator Warren and a group of us, eight of us, nine of us have put together, will ratchet off that ability to evade those critically important sanctions. I know I've gone over time, but I hope we can come back, Mr. Chairman, and revisit this issue in a broader way. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Warner. Senator Cortez Masto is recognized from Nevada.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the panelists. Let me associate myself with some of the comments by Senator Warner. And let me start with this. To the panelists, Mr. Levin, let me start with you. What are the illicit finance risks of digital assets? We are hearing from law enforcement agencies that there are still concerns around the use of cryptocurrency, that it's still an attractive vehicle for illicit financial activity. What do we need to be aware of?
Thank you, Senator. The law enforcement agencies that are responsible for investigating these illicit flows need more resources to be able to get their arms around this new technology. They have to adapt a whole new way of policing, and they need new techniques and methods to be able to get after these types of crimes, you know, particularly in the realm of cybercrime and cyber-enabled crime. You know, cryptocurrencies have been used to effect by those actors, but with the appropriate tooling, we've seen successes when it comes to, you know, everything from the types of money laundering infrastructure that helps facilitate these types of crimes. You know, Alexander Vinik is sitting in jail in France, having started BTCE, which was one of the major sort of Russian money laundering operations in historical sense. And so, you know, cryptocurrencies with the appropriate techniques from law enforcement agencies can actually, you know, combat these types of illicit flows.
And Mr. Mosier, do you feel the same way?
I do, Senator Cortez. Thank you for asking. And actually, I just want to underscore one part of what Mr. Levin said. As the acting director of FinCEN, I pushed and deputy director pushed and had the same argument with the Office of Management and Budget at the White House, repeatedly saying, there is an enormous amount of data here and transparency. We need the tools to be able to do it. What I got were questions of, why do you need more than one? Or why do you need more than one license? Can't you just call somebody else who has one and ask them to look it up? And I had to explain to them, as the former in-house counsel at Chainalysis, I am certain that is a violation of the license terms to simply not buy a license and have someone else look it up for you. And actually, the part of the benefit of having a public ledger and the ability to monitor in real time to go after the people that are doing these things is that you need the tools to do it in real time to benefit from this. We don't have to wait 3 years for a mutual legal assistance treaty, but we do need the resources to do it.
Right.
Thank you.
No, I appreciate that, because I also know the concern. As somebody, I've worked in law enforcement for a number of years, addressing money laundering issues, right? The drug cartels in Mexico, they're always trying to figure out how they can move cash, whether it's actually a briefcase full of cash, then to debit cards to some other form or system. And we're always trying to follow the money, as you said, and track it as quickly as possible to lead us to that criminal activity or terrorist activity, whatever it is. Do either of you think that digital currency or cryptocurrency is going away?
Senator, I don't think cryptocurrency is going away. In fact, you know, I think that, you know, it will continue to become a more important financial rail for commerce more broadly. And I think what you're seeing is that, you know, at the beginning of cryptocurrencies, we had, you know, cryptocurrencies that represented themselves and these communities that use them. But increasingly, you see it intersecting with a broad range of industries. And so if you look at the art market today, or you look at the music industry, or even, you know, how people manage their data for their electric vehicles, you know, there are ways in which these types of value are being represented on these cryptographically secure ledgers to introduce brand new ways of conducting markets. So I don't believe it's going away.
Thank you. And Mr. Stansberry, any comment to add to the questions that I've just asked?
No, Senator.
Thank you. And let me also say this to Mr. Chobanian. First of all, let me just say our thoughts are with you and your family and all Ukrainian citizens right now as they fight the cruel and deadly invasion ordered by Putin. And thank you for your comments around the benefits that you've seen right now with respect to the cryptocurrencies and the support for Ukraine. But is there concern that you have about how the people in Russia are opposing Putin's murderous regime by the use of cryptocurrency?
That's correct. They're running away from ruble, and most of them are running away physically from Russia. And the only way for them to exist outside of Russia right now is actually crypto, probably. Obviously, you're not being able to buy a house or a car, but at least you can survive.
Thank you. I know my time is up. I'm going to submit some of my questions for the record, the remaining of them. But this is such an important panel. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you, Senator Cortez Mesto. Senator Reid from Rhode Island is recognized.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And thank you, gentlemen, for your testimony. I think one of the premises we're beginning is that you can divide the world into good actors and bad actors. And the bad actors can use cryptocurrency with great efficiency and great effect. The good actors are, they're good people, but we're focused on the bad actors. And I think in chain analysis, you basically identify wallets that are connected to a bad actor. You know, how do you do that, Mr. Levin?
Thank you, Senator. So we track all cryptocurrency transactions. So not just the good actors and not just the bad actors, but we track the entire ecosystem to be able to map really which services are present, putting those transactions into these ledgers and facilitating the movement of currency. And so we track, when it comes to illicit activity, we track ransomware actors and all of their enablers by actually gathering intelligence about those ransomware campaigns. We can actually also make transactions with these types of actors. We have a team of about 50 people that are specialist researchers that conduct, you know, collection on these types of illicit activities and specialize in specific types of crime to be able to label that in our system so that not only our law enforcement partners can actually investigate those types of crimes, but our private sector customers can screen for that type of risk in these transactions and prevent it and report them as suspicious activity reports to FinCEN.
So effectively, you're employing human intelligence to analyze the activity that's going on, and then you're identifying the bad actors and communicating that to your clients and others. But how effective are you in identifying the bad actors, since there's so much anonymity in the system?
Thank you, Senator. Yes, so the way in which this works is that not only do we have the ability to collect human intelligence on these on this activity, but actually because of the transparency, we actually can actually, you know, further the identification of the activity beyond the individual incident that we have detected. And so maybe just to go back to the question about ransomware reporting from Senator Warner, is that actually we tend to have higher estimates of the amount of ransomware revenue being generated because we can take a solo incident of ransomware reporting and broaden that out to be able to identify all of the activity that campaign has been running. So I think it's important to see that, you know, we only need to see them once and we can then unravel the financial network due to the completeness of it and the transparency.
Just a final quick question, but can you reach down to identify in real individuals?
So, Senator, we do not collect information about individual people. That is collected by the regulated financial institutions that have to have their KYC processes, and then law enforcement typically uses, you know, their legal authorities to go and further their investigation and collect that piece of information. But the interesting thing is that the investigation can progress a lot faster and you can complete the picture of the entire financial network when it comes to cryptocurrencies without actually getting down into the individual identity.
just another quick question. Our assumption, I think, is that the oligarchs and the bad actors of the world deliberately have put in their portfolios a cryptocurrency. That is an avenue they want to exploit. Is that your sense too?
Senator, I think that assumption, maybe something that we can easily have a hypothetical scenario in which that is the case. I think when you look at the actual, data about the amount of wallets that are present and you look at the concentration of cryptocurrency and its use, I think that the most sophisticated actors in Russia when it comes to cryptocurrency have been largely around sort of large cybercrime rings and not sort of large sums of money with Russian oligarchs.
Thank you. Just a final question, and I don't expect an answer, but to what extent do we have to worry about cryptocurrency displacing fiat currency so that there is really no way for the Federal Reserve, for example, to control or attempt to control the economy? And
Senator, it's obviously a question that requires deep inspection. But the quick answer is that cryptocurrencies represent global communities and new ways of commerce, and I think it's more beneficial to view cryptocurrencies as truly a technology that enables a lot more industries and a lot more business models that can change the way that, away from, say, rent-seeking organizations to a much more distributed economy. And so I think that would complement, actually, the issuance of the dollar.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Sir, Senator Van Hollen of Maryland is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank all of you for your testimony. And I want to thank the chairman, ranking member, for holding a series of hearings on cryptocurrency because I think everybody's working to get up to speed on the public policy challenges. And clearly there are benefits, as been described in this hearing, and there are also risks. And I think it is fair to say, and I've been trying to follow the testimony from my office, is that for people who engage in ransomware, I mean, cryptocurrency is the preferred method of payment today. That happened in Baltimore City. Baltimore City was the victim of a ransomware attack. They insisted on payment in Bitcoin. That was the case in the Colonial Pipeline. I mean, we recovered some of it, a lot of it. But isn't that a fact that right now, at least the people perpetrating these crimes perceive this method of payment to be the best in terms of hiding their identity? Mr. Levin.
Thank you, Senator. And yes, I was very intimately familiar with the Baltimore case that where ransomware has affected people's lives. And so when it comes to being able to detect this, and the reason why criminals actually use it is they are economic actors, and so they are looking for methods that maximize profitability first, not necessarily their anonymity. And so, cryptocurrency has been used in ransomware cases because it's easy to acquire Bitcoin, it's easy to send that Bitcoin anywhere in the world, and that's why, it's risen to prominence inside ransomware. But those actors typically feel like they're beyond the, reach of the law, and that has systematically become not the case as we've become a lot better at detecting the entire financial network that actually enables ransomware. And so if you look at the NetWalker case where an affiliate of a ransomware campaign was arrested up in Canada, that is made possible because we can see the entire business model of these ransomware campaigns on the blockchain, and so we can identify those enablers and shut them off, which would, you know, start to disrupt the amount of ransomware that, that affects this country.
Right. So, and a lot of the testimony here has been that because of the blockchain technology, we are better able to at least track the identity of a digital wallet. Then there's always the challenge of figuring out who's behind the digital wallet. But the in the Colonial Pipeline case, as I understand it, the FBI was able to get the key to the digital wallet. Is that your understanding?
Senator, yes, that is my understanding too.
Which is a different method of recovering the payment than hacking into the system, or does that amount to the same thing?
So, Senator, I think the details of all of the way in which the FBI managed to retrieve those funds are not necessarily in the public domain, but the way in which this occurs is access to the key itself rather than hacking into the entire system. The system is always, you know, the Bitcoin system is secure. Someone's ability to hold those keys can be a vulnerability that could be exploited in those types of cases.
So I want to press this point a little bit because it's getting to the other side of the equation, which is on the one hand, people say, well, the cryptocurrencies are a secure way for someone, a criminal, to hide their assets. But we also have cases like Colonial Pipeline, but also cases where crypto exchanges have been hacked, right? I mean, there are numerous examples of crypto exchanges being hacked. Isn't that the case?
Yes, that is the case, Senator.
And you know, this committee's had a conversation about, you know, if you're an investor in a cryptocurrency, what's your recourse if a cryptocurrency exchange that you've invested in gets hacked? Are you able to recover your assets? And right now, there's no protection. Can you just speak, though, to the question of vulnerability and hacking in the crypto systems? Because that seems to be another area where, on the one hand, we say they're very difficult to penetrate, but increasingly this seems more like the arms race, right, where people just try to leap ahead of the technology. What is the vulnerability in terms of hacking?
Thanks, Senator. And it's an incredibly important issue, particularly for consumers. So when it comes to the ability to hack into exchanges, these are financial intermediaries where someone is holding funds on behalf of someone else. And in those instances, you know, that is where, you know, regulation can come in and be very helpful in establishing sort of best practices and standards by which those exchanges and financial intermediaries should hold funds the same way that other financial institutions do. And increasingly what you see is you actually see the largest custodians in the world, you know, the Bank of New York Mellons, actually come into crypto custody to be able to offer, you know, really robust custody solutions the same way that we have for traditional securities and other financial instruments. And so, you know, I think what we'll see is that, you know, there is an increase in the maturity of the types of actors actually entering this market, where those types of vulnerabilities, at least on the exchange level, will start to be closed. We do see, you know, vulnerabilities, you know, starting to emerge in other parts of the ecosystem that do also need some more attention. But this is something that, you know, matures over time with the technology and also with the actors that get involved in the industry. And so I think you're seeing a very positive direction with that, with the types of actors that are now stepping into the space.
Thank you. No, I agree with the ranking member's observation that this is an area that is here to stay and does require regulation, but we need to be, and we need to be very sort of up to speed on how we go about doing that. But this is one of the areas, it seems to me, where consumers beware, and where regulation could be important. Thank you,
Senator. Senator Sinema is recognized from her office, from Arizona, from her office.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the witnesses for being here today. Arizonans and Americans stand with the people of Ukraine in opposition to Russia's illegal war. Just yesterday, we heard from President Zelensky in a joint address to Congress about the tools Ukrainians need to defend themselves. I'm committed to working with my Senate colleagues to deliver more military equipment and humanitarian support to Ukrainians. Our efforts to crack down on illicit financing are an integral part of this strategy as we work to break the supply chains and the financing of Putin's war machine and to bring this needless violence to an end. Mr. Levin, thank you for being here today. Your company, Chainalysis, has helped law enforcement and our sanctions professionals track down illicit activity on the blockchain. I appreciate your team's willingness to proactively brief my staff last year on your company's work. For many, the idea that your company could help connect illicit activity on a supposedly anonymous platform to real people is surprising. Your testimony spoke to this, but briefly, how does your company manage to catch illicit activity in cryptocurrency without attempting to break the blockchain or undermine the integrity of the distributed ledger?
Thank you, Senator, for the question. The ability for us to actually detect illicit activity on the blockchain depends on our ability to actually see the transactions. And so the public nature of the blockchain means that our team can look at every single transaction that has ever happened in the majority of cryptocurrencies. And we use, you know, a combination of human intelligence where we're actually able to collect information and transact on these networks with our machine learning algorithms that allow us to tie different transactions together to form a full picture of the way that, you know, services are being used by people to use cryptocurrency technology both for good and for bad. And so, you know, what it takes is a team of specialists and a lot of dedication over the last 8 years to build an expertise in how cryptocurrencies can be abused. And we're able to map out, you know, the full, you know, wallet infrastructure that these illicit actors are using and provide that in our tools both to our private sector customers and the public sector.
Well, thank you. Some more sophisticated criminals will use tactics like chain hopping or make use of Mixer and Tumblr services, where they will repeatedly move transactions between and within cryptocurrencies to make it harder to track funds. Do your company's services offer an effective response to these evasion tactics? And what is the biggest limiting factor in the services that your company can provide?
Thank you, Senator. So, yeah, when it comes to the issues of chain hopping and mixing, I'll take them separately. So the ability to chain hop often requires, you know, transactions where you lock up a cryptocurrency asset on one chain to unlock a wrapped version on another chain, which is commonly referred to as chain hopping. You know, that activity can be seen on the blockchain, and, you know, we've released the ability to actually do cross-chain investigations on our investigation platform so that that type of activity actually doesn't provide the level of anonymity that it may seem in the name of it. When it comes to mixing services, you know, we have, and not necessarily, you know, completely publicly, you know, been seen to actually have techniques that have the ability to demix certain transactions. And so, you know, our research and development efforts, you know, consistently keep up with the way that people try and obscure themselves in financial transactions. And we have actually seen, you know, successes operationally, and we would be happy to follow up with a separate briefing on that, to, you know, actually find ways to demix transactions and find the individuals responsible at the end of it. So that's where we, you know, invest R&D efforts in continuing to keep up and actually stay ahead mostly of, you know, the way in which criminals use or abuse cryptocurrencies.
Thank you. Mr. Chobanian, thank you so much for being here with us today. And I want to express my continued solidarity with the people of Ukraine. Yesterday, President Zelensky signed a law legalizing cryptocurrency in Ukraine. Can you share a bit about why this law is important and how Web3 technologies are providing new tools to help the people of Ukraine weather this illegal war and unprecedented humanitarian crisis?
Hello, thank you. So yeah, we have an official law now. The next step would be to make changes to the tax laws. And after that, the law would be in place. So basically what it does, it provides rules of the game for the business in crypto on how we can operate, whether we can open a bank account, obviously we will be. What are the rules for AML, KYC in regards with crypto, who's in charge, whether us or the banks, and so on and so on. So basically, within the year after we finish the war, we're going to have the full market. And I see that you're still discussing whether to ban or allow crypto in US. So I invite all US companies to come to Ukraine and open up there. You can use it, Ukraine, as a sandbox for US. I don't see a problem here. So Web 3.0, it's just been basically going to change the world. It will be the technology that we're going to use to rebuild my country, namely the blockchain, because it shows the transparency of everything. And that's the main topic that we've been discussing for the past hour. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Sinema. Thank you. Senator Daines is recognized.
Yeah. Chairman Brown, thank you.
From Montana.
I think this topic is really important for us to be discussing, given sort of the war in Ukraine, these recent comments. I strongly believe that President Biden should have never given the green light on Putin's Nord Stream 2 pipeline in the first place. In fact, I had Ukrainian leaders in my office September 30th. They went back and grabbed the memo. Leaders from Odessa, deputy mayor, former member of parliament, current member of parliament, they were in my office pleading with us to stop the Nord Stream 2 pipeline. That was September 30th. And while I'm disappointed, my colleagues across the aisle, and by the way, if you want to see what's going on with Odessa, just look at the latest press reports. They're gearing up right now. They think that's going to be the next battle city. They call it the southern capital of Ukraine, beautiful port city, the Black Sea, and the Russians look like they're headed there next, and they're hoping to save this beautiful opera house, other great community there in Odessa, but it is what it is at the moment. I'm disappointed that my colleagues across the aisle voted against reimposing sanctions on the Russian pipeline earlier on, despite the pleas from the Ukrainians. I believe we can all agree that the sanctions have been imposed thus far have had a significant impact on the Russian economy, that's probably to say the least. And while it's possible, it's unclear to me that digital assets are being used by Russia to evade the sanctions in any meaningful way. In fact, Treasury officials, including the Financial Crimes Enforcement Network, have stated this to be the case. Legitimate crypto intermediaries, such as Coinbase, Gemini, others abide by KYC and AML standards and are actively updating their standards to comply with the sanctions. Even actors utilizing the so-called dark web typically need to involve a financial institution obligated to AML and sanctions requirements to convert crypto assets into fiat currency. At the same time, we've seen the Ukrainian government explicitly solicit crypto donations. On Monday, the Ukrainian government launched a crypto donation website, partnering with FTX, Everstake, and the Kuna Exchange based in Ukraine, which will route donated crypto to the National Bank of Ukraine. According to the Ukrainian government, over $100 million in crypto donations have poured into the website and other smaller funds. This demonstrates, I believe, how powerful crypto and other digital assets can be as a tool to revolutionize finance and the speed at which donations can flow around the world. Now, turning to my questions. Mr. Mogier, can you describe the process of converting digital assets into fiat? And related to that, would someone trying to evade sanctions be able to do this? Mr. Mogier, yes, Mr. Mogier.
Thank you for the question, Senator Daines. So actually, it's a complicated process because you've got to get liquidity on the other side to begin with. Someone has to want your rubles, and there are not a lot of people in the world right now that want rubles. So you have the market problem. Second, you have to find somebody that's willing to make that trade that also feels comfortable that they're not violating any sort of global laws that they're going to come after with, whether it's sanctions, domestic currency controls, but most likely it's not going to be anyone outside of Russia, that's for sure, because first of all, no one wants the ruble, and secondly, they've got their own jurisdictions enforcement to look at, and they've got global sanctions in probably the most united front that we've seen, certainly in the Western Bloc.
So drawing from your past experience at the Office of Foreign Assets Control in FinCEN, do you think blockchain technology provides certain benefits with regard to the ease of detecting illicit financial flows?
Absolutely, I do, Senator. And I think it's an important question because there's two benefits to blockchain technology that are important to think of from an American perspective. And that's one is the ability to much faster hone in on what is the bad actor that we need to worry about because you can follow the transactions almost indefinitely. And it's an immutable public ledger, which means you can share that information with partners around the world. But I think there's another important piece here that we're sometimes talking about privacy like it's an obstacle, but privacy is part of the Constitution as a matter of security and personal sovereignty. that is not just something to slow down investigations. It's something that we also want to protect vulnerable people. That's why we have subpoenas. That's why there's court process about this. And so what this does is, instead of the dragnets that Senator Toomey had mentioned before, is you focus on what we've already identified through activity.
I would think the Ukrainians at the moment would be very sensitive to the issue of privacy.
Exactly. Absolutely, sir.
In the remaining time, I want to ask a question, Mr. Chobanian. Mr. Chobanian, can you describe how the Ukrainian government has utilized the crypto donations that have been received to date?
Sure. It's a public information. So we bought helmets, bulletproof vests. We bought the first aid kits, blood-stopping wound, something. I don't know what's the real name of it. The scopes. And then we bought a lot of ration for the soldiers, so close to 500,000. We delivered money to, for example, people in Mariupol, to people in Kharkiv, to people in Sumy. So we actually send money to the crypto enthusiasts in those cities, and they managed to buy, well, first of all, exchange it to local currency or directly using crypto buy food and distribute it among the citizens of those cities. So these are the examples of how we're using money. Everything is transparent, so it's fantastic. I'd say this is like life-saving thing that it's impossible to do with the regular banking system.
Yeah, I'm out of time, Mr. Chairman. Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Senator Daines. And Senator Toomey, in the interest of time, Senator Toomey has one short question. I will provide a question in writing to Mr. Stansberry, and then we'll wrap.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, for that indulgence. The question is for Mr. Chobanian, and I, reading a section of the legislation that Senator Warren referred to, one of the things I'm concerned about is it would impose the equivalent of really secondary sanctions on anyone doing business, crypto business, with anyone from Russia. Now, I know the intent is to go after oligarchs, but it looks to me like it would have a hugely negative impact on anybody in Russia engaged in any kind of crypto transactions. And so my question, Mr. Chobanian, is could you just talk to us a little bit about the overlap or the correlation between those Russian people who use crypto and those who are opposed to what Putin is doing, those who are maybe hostile to his regime?
There is a very good correlation here. A lot of, first of all, the people who are using crypto in Russia are at least intelligent. They have money and they understand technology. So these are clever people, obviously. And they don't watch TV, so they are not zombies of the regime. So they understand what's happening around the world. They travel the world. They see the Western world. They see how it's different to the regime in Russia. So these people are actually our closest friends because they oppose Putin just as much as we do. Unfortunately, they can't really do much because they don't have any instruments to fight the regime, at least from their point of view. So for us, yeah, it's very important to, and I want to stress this out again, that it's very important that we don't block the regular people in Russia who are actually opposition within Russia. We only have to go after the sanctioned list and sanctioned people. And these people actually have much, much more wealth accumulated. So for them, it's probably the average amount that they want to hide is like in hundreds of millions. For the regular Russians, it's probably $1,000 or $10,000 so in equivalent. So we have to make sure that we don't block these people and we still allow for the opposition to survive. Both within Russia and outside, because as you know, they can't use Visa MasterCard cards outside of Russia right now. So the only means of payments they have is cash or crypto. That's it. And considering that all of the AML KYC rules that are imposed in the world right now, you can only exchange crypto to like sums of, I think it's $1,000 in most of the jurisdictions. So we have to make sure that we don't, cut off these people from actually surviving.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator Toomey. For senators who wish to submit questions for the record, those questions are due 1 week from today, Thursday, March 24th. Witnesses please, if you can, well, you'll have 45 days to respond to any questions. Thank you again. Interesting testimony from the four of you. Thank you. And Mr. Chobanian, especially good luck to you. The committee's adjourned. Thanks. Thank you.